So I'm John Carney, and I wrote and directed this film once.
And I'm Glen, Hansard, I played the guy.
I'm Markéta, Irglová, and I play the girl.
And that there is Darren Healy urinating down a lane in Dublin in January of 2006. Darren's a brilliant actor who we got in to play this scene as this kind of character who, I guess, comes along to, what I like about the opening of this film is that you're not sure who's the lead yet. There's a guy playing the guitar, there's a guy clapping his hands and pissing down a laneway. So it could be either guy. And Darren's a brilliant actor, and he was very, very much kind of in character on the day that we were shooting this sequence. And it was very funny. He was reluctant to get into kind of discussing the scene with Glen, who he didn't know, but also because he was in character, he was kind of nervous about getting out of this heroin addict's headspace. So he kind of had, it was quite funny. We were communicating through me. So Darren would come and give me, as a director, notes, and I'd tell them to Glen and vice versa, because Darren wanted to stay in character. And as you can see, he does a pretty amazing job as this kind of heroin addict. What's good, I guess, about this scene in a way is that you learn without the normal kind of expositional kind of script things, you learn a lot about the lead character, who's obviously this guy playing the guitar now, when you come to realize it. Because he could be a lot harder with this character than he actually is, who he's being stolen from, or who's stealing all his stuff. So this was like day two of our shoot, and we had cameras hidden on long lenses, as you can see by how shaky they are. And I think in the first take, when Darren runs off with that bag of money, I think somebody actually stood out from behind a van and gave him an almighty kick in the bollocks. Didn't realize that this was a film. And I was like, keep rolling, that's brilliant, that's brilliant. And your man was, what? Excuse me? This is my future children you're talking about here. I think this is about take three or four.
I'm sorry, man, I'm just fucking dying sick, you know what I mean? I look like I'm heavy.
Weirdly, some people who watch this film, who watch this scene, think that these two are related. Like, I've read a number of little blogs online where people say that scene between the two brothers at the beginning, and I've never known what it is that makes them think that they're brothers. I mean, it's obvious that they know each other.
I think it's because he says, how's your ma, at one point.
Yeah, and maybe they hear it as, how's our ma?
All right.
It's funny, having been on tour in America with this film, actually people, a lot of, you know, a good percentage of the audience don't actually care that you can't hear a lot of the dialogue. Which is interesting, I guess, because it's a musical film and it's more about mood and tone than actually understanding every beat of what's going on. And I guess it's the only one film I've ever heard of where Americans seem to overlook the fact that a lot of the dialogue you can't hear. So that's the pre-title sequence, really. The title once refers to a male condition, not particular to Ireland, but it's certainly prevalent in Ireland, which is a lot of guys that I know who are very talented and very, you know, have a lot to say about the world and are witty and urbane and funny, but kind of sit behind the pint of Guinness and are very creative people, but they just don't have the kind of the get up and go. So, and you hear that line a lot with these people. It's, you know, once I get enough money, once I get out of my parents' house, or, you know, once I get this little business set up, or once I get my great script written, and, you know, I'll be brilliant. And they're not actually doing it. They're kind of, I guess it's the guy hiding behind the pint of Guinness, or the, you know, who could be great, but just keeps putting it off and keeps procrastinating. And it ties in with the lead character, who is a talented guy, has, you know, talent to burn, but doesn't have a huge amount of motivation, doesn't really have much belief in himself. And he's kind of like, he's in that kind of position in life where he didn't leave Ireland when he was young enough, or didn't do something with his life when he was young enough. Now his girlfriend has kind of fled, she's in England or wherever she is, and he's kind of he's humming and hawing and doesn't quite know where he's going. And there's a lot of men that I know that have that problem, so that's kind of where the title ties in for me. It's kind of, once I do this, once I do that, suddenly the world will make sense. This is a reshoot as well. We shot this sequence two nights in a row because the difficulty of controlling people on Grafton Street.
And if you notice in the background, the Dunn Stores, it's got the spring collection, and we shot the film in January, but we had to go back because this scene was never got. We actually had to go back like a few weeks later, and they changed the window display. So it's very weird. I'm in the same spot in the song before this, except it's the January sales, and when it cuts to this scene, it's the spring collection.
Two different seasons in the one scene. And I thought this shot was interesting. I mean, I guess it's this and the final shot, which we won't talk about yet, are the only two kind of shots, if you like, you know, the two kind of reasonably choreographed moments of the film where the camera goes from a very wide shot into a slow tracking shot into a mid close-up of him, and then pulls back very slowly as the end of the song, and reveals. And reveals. The girl.
For me, this was this must have been really early in the shoot, this scene, because I didn't really find the character. I had troubles finding the girl in the first couple of days of shooting. You know, it's the case every time. I guess it must be where you're trying to find the character, because I wasn't playing myself, and I had to figure. I had to find her within me, and this scene was quite early on in the shoot. And I really, from the first moment I was reading the script, I liked this scene very much because I thought it was so well written and I wanted to get the scene right. And I got a little bit scared when I saw how early on it was. But then it almost seemed like I found the girl in this scene, which was really nice for me. And because it was really nice that it was kept and that John was happy with it, because I thought that was really important to get the scene right. And looking back at it now, I think we did a good job, even though you should have seen what was going on in my head. Mm-hmm.
True
that scene.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think this is a very winning scene for her, for this character here, actually. The way you play this is really good.
And that's Johnny Cash on the cover of The Big Issue.
Is it really?
Yeah. Okay. He's gone.
You love her still? So it is. Jesus, man.
Plus, all the street scenes were so hard, because it was hard enough when there was just the you know, the cameraman and the light person around, but when there was actual people on the street who'd sometimes stop and listen, that was quite hard.
Hmm.
I'd get really nervous.
I always was worried as well that you were a bit too beautiful in the scene.
It looks like I'm wearing loads of makeup.
Yeah, that's what I thought, exactly. That was like, oh my God, have we made a complete mistake with the makeup in this scene?
But I'm wearing none.
Yeah, no, I know, we did very little.
I think it was just good light.
Yeah. Or just good looks.
Thanks, Joe.
But I guess for me it was like the character looks after herself. You know, she... You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That worked. I've broken me all the way down. Down upon my knees, and you have broken me all the way now. You'll be the last you'll see.
Son, fire. Catherine, leave a message. That's the ex.
There's the ex. The betrayer. Away. Again, I like this all. It's very little dialogue. It's hints. You know, he doesn't leave a message. What does that mean? What does it mean when somebody rings you up and then doesn't leave a message and then looks at your picture like that? What can that mean?
There's Leonard Cohen up above my shoulder. That was a nice coincidence.
And there's Bill Hadnett, who's a great actor.
I love that shop. It was like it looked like a Radiohead album cover.
It's a brilliant shop. That's a real shop, actually, in Harold's Cross in Dublin, and it's exactly the way it is there. And it's one of those dying shops, you know, one of those dying trades in Ireland where we caught up with the rest of Europe and people just throw stuff out now if it doesn't work. You don't repair it. I brought in my shoes the other day to be repaired. Nice pair of old leather shoes from the 70s, and the guy was like, "You kidding me? Cost me 120 to fix them. Throw them out." And I couldn't get anybody in Dublin to fix them.
I really like this montage scene. It's very much the life of a busker, you know, a day in the life.
Hmm.
No, it's really interesting to hear when you're in the cinema watching the film how much laughter this gets when the girl shows up with the Hoover on the street. Actually, when she's pulling it, it's the one thing that we wouldn't have thought people would laugh at.
We didn't play it for laughs at all. Yeah.
No, I bring it today.
I think Paul Mullen, the editor of this film, did a great job on this scene. Really, he left all the kind of the... Look, he's still not convinced.
Yeah, but you don't understand.
I come with you then?
You know, she has to go through about three or four different phases of getting him to hang with her.
You hungry? I'm always hungry.
I'm always hungry. I kind of thought that line was a bit dodgy, but... We faded it down slightly on the track, I think, in the mix.
This is Simon's Cafe in town. This is a place where we would always go and basically spend a couple of hours every day if we're in the city. So it felt really nice to shoot the scene there. We did that a lot with this film, where we just shot in places that we really liked personally.
This is a great cafe. Got a nice sandwich. And the waitresses are incredible. In that they're really fast in serving you coffee. So. Again, people really like this scene because you see more of Dublin in the reflection of the window than you do of them. Which, of course, was intentional. But it does kind of, I guess, make the characters a little bit kind of like integrated into the cityscape around them, and as opposed to being two movie actors.
I remember this was one of those days where I really flagged. I was really tired during that scene. Do you remember how wrecked you were?
Okay. It's also nice to see this character warming up to her, because she tries so hard to get him into her life. And throughout these scenes, you can see how he's beginning to be interested in her, which I always enjoy.
She sort of kicks down the door, really, doesn't she? He doesn't look like the kind of person who would, you know, very naturally just become someone's friend.
Mm.
Seems like he's all about his dad, you know, helping in the shop, doing a bit of busking. He's kind of a private fella, and this girl bursts away into his life and then plays this amazing piece of music.
And this really is where the film begins, I guess. The stuff up to it is a preamble. I guess the idea was to make a kind of a musical film that would appeal to a younger audience of people, a more modern audience of people, who wouldn't necessarily accept the Gene Kelly, Frank Sinatra breaking into song thing that I happen to actually really enjoy, but I guess they you know, a modern audience won't get past the fact that people are breaking into song walking down the street, unless the film is very kind of self-consciously made. So I wanted to make an unself-conscious musical, something that was you know, very cheaply made and was very like a kind of, I guess, an independent small film, but yet was actually a musical that was full of songs that were in their whole, you know, songs that didn't begin and just kind of fade off or cut to something else. But the music was actually the chief way the characters were communicating. So I wanted to do a modern musical. The idea was that the songs were stitched into the drama of the piece, that they were justified by the events that were taking place and by the character's state of mind in the film, that they weren't just kind of, you know, I can't stand the way music is used in modern films just to kind of push the plot along and keep things moving and keep things lively and entertaining. I, you know, for me, I'm a musician. Chiefly, I left school to be a musician, and, you know, in my life there's always a guitar handy, and, you know, you if you're a musician, you do end up kind of integrating songs into your life. You know, you play a song that you're working on to your girlfriend, or a tune that you like, or that, you know. The idea, in a way, I guess, is, you know, you're rowing with your partner all night long, trying to get to the meaning of life or your relationship, and you row and you argue and you discuss, and then at the end of the day at 6 o'clock in the morning some country and western singer comes on the radio and sings a 3-minute song, and you kind of go, that's kind of what I meant. And so to me songs are very much part of life anyway, and you can cut out 10 pages of dialogue by listening to a good Tom Waits song or a good Johnny Cash song or a, dare I say it, a good Steely Dan song. For me, it was like I had known Glen for years. I'd been in the Frames years and years ago, back in the early 90s. So I knew Glen. I was very familiar with his music and what he was trying to do with his music.
Well, it became quite clear to me that John was going to leave the Frames after about a year and a half. He just had this kind of restless, sense of him. And I knew that he was really into film and he really wanted to go make films. So I guess, you know, it was one of those things where I bought him an 8mm, like a, you know, basically a Super 8 camera, and a clapperboard. I remember bringing him back a clapperboard and saying, like, you know, as in almost like that was the token. There you go, going, you know, go do your thing. And I'm actually really happy he went off and he made a bunch of films that you know, through the years I caught one or two and really enjoyed them. And so for me, it's a very, very, it's kind of like a long completed circle now that I've actually been in one of John's films. You know, playing my own song. So it's kind of it's really fantastic. It's kind of strange for me that the first guy who jumped my ship, if you like, ironically, might be the one guy who brings most attention to it. which I think is very ironic and kind of nice.
From the very, very first thought of this film, Glen was the person that I had thought of to write the music. And so I proposed the idea to him and told him the story, and he seemed to like that and said that he'd write some songs for it. And then kind of weirdly, just over developing the project and conversations, he'd introduced me to Markéta, who he'd known, and she was perfect for the lead female. She was a great singer and a really good pianist and had a really good way about her. So I met her through Glen, and the project really did have a very organic kind of coming about. It was very, I had thought of actors in the lead roles, and I was going to get, for a while I was going to get, you know, a couple of Irish actors that could sing that I really wanted to be in the film. And I was thinking that I'd get some famous Czech Republic actor or Polish actress to play the lead female role. But it became very quickly clear that rather than getting kind of, good actors that could half sing, I'd go with good singers that could half act. Because the whole thing in this was that the songs have to be performed brilliantly. And it became very clear that actually nobody's going to quite sing these songs as convincingly as the people who wrote them. The script I think ended up being about 60 pages long, which is about, I guess, 70% of what a normal script would be, which I guess comes in around 100 and 120 pages long. But I had always wanted to do something that would be less about dialogue and more about process and more about tone than reams of really good dialogue or plot points or structured film scripts. Because I think the emphasis recently on coming up with the perfect script, I think we were kind of, we're obsessing with that idea. You have to remember that films originally were silent films, and the script was merely like a call sheet. It was a kind of a list of things that we had to get through today. They were, 10 pages long. And now they're in Hollywood, and there's this huge emphasis on getting the perfect script, and people tend to forget, actually, cinema is a visual art form. So for me, the script was more of a story than a perfectly polished script, and we came to each scene each day and would sit down and discuss it, and occasionally would throw out lines or indeed throw out the whole scene and say, let's just find this scene by rolling the camera and having you guys perform, and then we'll find it. And I have a lot of confidence in the idea that if you put two good actors who know what they're doing and who get on with the director and there's a vibe between them, that you'll come up with something really interesting. And I think that once is a case in point in a way. I mean, I did work on the script, and I spent, I guess, about kind of 2 or 3 months writing dialogue and structuring the story and stuff, and I'd bounce it off Glen and Mar and, give them ideas for scenes, and they would say they liked this and they didn't like that. And I said, could you write a song that was, or fashion a song, I guess, that you already have? Could you change it slightly to suit this idea? And also I would listen to their songs and get inspired for ideas and scenes. So I guess all told, really, really the script was a story more than a perfect script. And I really enjoyed that process.
The costumes, it was interesting that this jacket I'm wearing and the top and the jeans, and I kind of wanted to look like it's a very maybe pretentious thing to say, but I always really liked the look of the kid in 400 Blows, the Truffaut film, and I really liked his jacket. So I have had this one for years, and I thought it looked similar, so I wore it. Mar changes clothes a few times. I think I'm in the same clothes with the whole film.
A lot of the props in the film, a lot of the costumes, a lot of the things are Glen and Mar's, which gives, I think, the film a great kind of sense of naturalism. And again, I don't know why I included that shot of your man. I just thought it was kind of, there's a couple of shots, I guess, in the film where you step outside the two characters and you see somebody else appreciate what they're doing in the recording studio later on, and him.
Again, this is just us walking from Simon's Cafe down to George's Arcade. Another great Dublin place.
Yeah. This is a reshoot that we shot after having made the film. We came back to do the scene.
I moved back in about a year ago, not to be mad, or just to have it down.
This is a funny and interesting scene, I guess, in as much as there's an awful lot. Basically, we were troubled at any stage with any stage in the film, specifically in this film, where any character kind of said too much or described their life, or I didn't want to rely on formal expositional kind of cliches. So he basically tells his story through a bunch of jokey songs here. I was shooting that scene, and we had met, myself and Glen and Mar had met in a hotel room in the night before, because these were reshoots when we did the bus scene, I pitched this idea. What do you think of this idea that he doesn't really explain what happens in his past? He does it through song, and he, you know, so he does a little Elvis impression or a Johnny Cash kind of thing. And he, this is the way he communicates his story because he's a bit embarrassed or he's reluctant to get into it. And Glenn liked that idea, and we met and we took the guitar out and we took a mini disc and we started just recording some ideas, just as a way of kind of rehearsing the idea. There was a death metal song, and Glenn did a country and western song. And we were fine. Okay, let's shoot it tomorrow. And we shot it the next day. And I was operating one of the cameras, and it came to that line, I'm a broken-hearted Hoover fixer sucker guy, which Glenn just improvised on the... And, you know, when you hear that for the first time, I just buckled over with laughter. It was such a perfect, funny little phrase. And again, it was. I mean, we just jumped on a bus and filmed the scene and just kind of got on with it. But people, you know, that's... People are really wary and reluctant. When I tell those stories, people are amazed. But we're like, big deal. You know, camcorder is a small thing. You don't need huge arc lights and 35 mil and a bunch of... You know, if you have some way of getting a bit of sound, getting your picture and syncing them up, you know, go off and make your bleeding movie. Like, it doesn't matter where it's made or how it's made. At the end of the day, an audience just want to see a director's vision and see, you know, they'll be satisfied with that, as long as it's not unwatchable, which I hope this film isn't.
This was our metal segue. This woman was brilliant. She was okay. She was great fun.
And now she's going to die. Back in Harold's Cross. On a rainy January day.
Some fella comes to me. Here, Johnny Nilfisk.
Really here? Yeah.
And the Phillips.
That little wink as well, we could have done that in a tighter shot, but I like the way only 20% of the audience will ever see that because it's so wide.
Oh no, I meant the songs.
Oh, right.
I really enjoyed doing this scene. I thought it was very warm.
It was just a belt.
Thank you. How much do I owe you?
Oh, you're kind, Jeff. It's
just
free.
Nothing's for free. How much?
Again, this scene is more about the dad really liking the fact that she insist on giving something over. You know, it's just the way she'd do business. Is, you know, nothing is for free. You have to at least show that you're willing to.
Pleasure to meet you, sir.
To make some sort of deal.
Take care.
Coming up here now is the most difficult scene, I guess, of the film.
So embarrassing, this scene. It's so hard to do. This is someone else's bedroom. We shot this in some friend's house. I don't know the person, so if all the posters on the wall and stuff are belong to someone else, which is interesting. There's a couple that I would agree with.
Yeah.
So this is the scene where basically the guy tries it on, and I just think Mara's reaction is absolutely brilliant in this.
And this is one of the scenes that we took a long time to shoot.
Can you transfer stuff on this for me so I can listen?
Yeah.
I have to go now.
Do you want to stay?
This is really hard.
Stay the night.
What? Fuck this.
Oh. It's very difficult to do that scene, you know, because how do you react when she's left? It seemed a little weak to me, but maybe it worked.
No, I think it does work. There are moments when you imitate scenes you've seen in films.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're almost so tiny. Everybody was so close. The cameras were... That was one of the few scenes that the cameras were so close up because the room was tiny. Mm.
But this is a great scene. I think it's a good idea in the film to have that little moment where he tries it on with her, because the way he comes back here, I think... is great, because it's very authentic and it's quite sincere, but it also shows to her that he's sincerely interested in her as a person, and he's made this bit of an effort to burn the CDs for her and track her down. And for me, this is a good scene because their relationship is now kind of on a level playing field. It's no longer about attraction or sex, it's just about music.
She's doing one of her other jobs, which is selling roses. She does like sells big issue roses. What else do you do, Mara?
I work in that lady's house.
Is it okay if I walk along with you a bit? Yeah.
Most Irish people.
There's a guy taking a photograph of us right here. It's really weird. Check it out.
No, it's the next thing.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. there's a scene where there's a guy standing right behind us taking a photo, and you just don't notice it unless you look for it.
There's Bewley's. We're over now in Mountjoy Square in the north side of Dublin. And these five guys. I mean, you see this a lot now in Mountjoy Square. You know, houses which have again become occupied, that were, you know, offices for long periods of time, that now have various families living in different rooms and different floors. So it's a really interesting kind of vibey area that will have a really interesting future, I think.
It's kind of the closest.
That's me running down the stairs, by the way.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
It's kind of the closest Dublin gets to like New York, that atmosphere.
Yeah.
Multicultural part of Dublin.
And this was just a vacant room, like an abandoned kind of room in this house that we dressed, which took us about 10 minutes. It was like everything in this film. It was really very, very, very low rent, which was great because it gave us a lot of freedom and pretty much the spirit of the way the film was made.
I don't know how we got those scenes with the kid down, because it was so hard.
So difficult.
I had this idea before shooting the film that when I heard it, I was supposed to have a kid, that I'd spent hours and hours with this kid so that she'd become used to me, and then, you know, we could get on and stuff. And I didn't spend any time, and her mother was basically in the corner of that room so that she wouldn't cry.
Mm. And this woman who plays the girl's mother in the film is hilarious. Our casting director, Maureen Hughes, was looking for a Czech woman that could play this part, and she was having a difficult time, and she met this woman who worked in the Fitzwilliam Hotel or some hotel in Dublin. And I met her at the bar, myself and Maureen, and, you know, we had no money, and I was describing this film, and she had very little English, and I'm convinced she thought we were making a porno. No, Jenny, I think she was like, what? I said, you know, we make film, and we'll see you on Monday with the cameras. And she was like, and who is in the film? And I said, no, nobody that you'd know.
This woman was actually really nice, because I met her during the shoot, and we both were basically dressed in these clothes that are really not very Czech. I mean, we don't dress like that in Czech Republic, and I tried to put that across to the costume girl, but she had this idea of us looking that way, so I just left her there then. But she came on set dressed in these clothes, being really upset about the fact that she's dressed. It was very funny. She was wearing all these fake gold, and it was almost like they dressed her up as a gypsy or something. And it was very funny how touchy she was about it, which I totally understand.
Careful, Michael, don't do that.
Because most of the times when I say I'm from Czech Republic, people don't even know where it is.
She dresses a bit like Moima.
Yeah, she does, actually.
He's at home.
This is where the Polish men come in.
I ate so much of this toast. I was really hungry, actually. So it was great. It was one of those scenes where I was actually stuffing me gob, really enjoying it.
Yeah, but you ate all of it before we were shooting the scene, and then we were actually shooting it. You were stuffed and you couldn't eat anymore.
Are you not pregnant?
These guys were great.
There's an Irish TV show called Fair City, and then the guys were basically, the joke was that we learn English from Fair City, and these were just a bunch of phrases like, how are you doing, man, or what's the story? And these guys were basically reeling it off. They were brilliant.
This is a piece of plastic that Glen is carrying in. I hate to tell you, it's so fake.
But it's a plastic doll. Though.
Do they?
Yeah.
No, actually. Really? Do they? Do
you know? They always tell me, that's a plastic doll, isn't it? And I'm like, yes.
Really, God. I thought I was convinced.
Because it was impossible to get the girl silent. She kept crying.
Yeah, well, we tried to carry the real girl in, but she wouldn't have it.
Yeah.
This is setting up this third song in the film. When I was writing the scenario for the film, I had come up with a bit of a block there. I was thinking, how can I have another song here? And I was struggling with that slightly. I didn't want another real moment where you sit down and they do a live performance. I wanted something that was slightly dreamlike. And I thought that it was just a really interesting idea that she would write these lyrics, she would go and get these batteries, and she would have this weird little walk home at night through the city centre of Dublin, which is quite a tough area of Dublin, Mountjoy Square. It's you know, it's as Glen was saying earlier, you know, it's a hard, tough inner city area, and there's this little girl kind of drifting through it with these headphones on, singing this very romantic song, and presumably people who are walking past can hear her.
I was having a bit of trouble with it. It's too romantic for me.
It is romantic. You have a romantic streak.
I used to have a romantic streak.
When?
When I was your age, I suppose.
Yeah, see, you're an old man now.
Yeah, dying. Cynical.
You have to go now. Go. Thanks for the Hoover and food and songs.
No problem. Thanks for the company. I need it.
Me too.
You don't want to go for a light coffee or a walk or something, no?
I can't. See you.
Right. See you.
This is now tidying up now before bed.
There's a nice edit of her here, a kind of a jump cut on the seat here where it just goes into her close-up. Again, suggests that this is a distraction to her. Normally, she would just go to bed. Now she's got this little thing to do, and she goes and writes these lyrics, which are out of loneliness and out of being bored and her kid being asleep and this Irish man having come into her life. Fuck you, batteries. I quite like that line. Nobody else likes it.
Also, people always say that I should have said that line in Czech, but those are the cynics, so. Never mind then.
Yeah. I guess you would if you were saying it to yourself.
Yeah, but sometimes, you know, I've hung out in Ireland so much that now sometimes I come home from Ireland and I actually even think in English, which is very strange.
Right. I guess that's quite common, isn't it?
I'll pay you back.
And you delivered that line seriously, I'll pay you back, which I went for in the end, even though I thought it was a kind of a playful line. When I'd written it, it was kind of like, I'll pay you back. And it works, I think, in a weird way that she's a tiny bit guilty about taking money from the for her own.
This scene, I love that these girls standing outside the shop because they were just there. This is their local shop. We were there with a camera and they were all just standing around going, what are they doing? They're making a film and they're just looking right into the lens and they're curious about what Mara's doing. And it's just fascinating.
We just went with it. And there were a number of takes in which they weren't there. And we kind of got the scene that we had gone out to shoot. And this one was by far the most interesting shot in the film.
What's amazing here is that the girls start skating after Mara, like totally naturally. Well, you see, when the drums come in.
Mm. It's just one girl, actually. She just kind of floats along by the left of that yellow thing there. She just drifts along like a little angel when the drums and bass come in, yeah.
It's so fascinating. And they followed us all the way up the street. Except you don't see them in the background anymore when we're doing the other shots.
Isn't it Robert Altman that said that good film direction is somebody who lets accidents happen? Because normally, you know, when you make a film, the first AD there would shout, okay, cut, cut, this kid's in the background. And, like, I'm not the type of person that would ever fire anybody off a film set, but it's the one time when you look at somebody who's started to direct the film themselves, you know, like a first AD or a location person will shout cut and you look over to them and you go, I'm the one who says cut. It's the one time when you actually do feel angry that normally, you know, you just never let something like that go in a film where the camera shakes or somebody looks down the camera. Actually, that can be really interesting when you watch the film back the next day it rushes and you go, actually, that was really good. I wish we hadn't cut. So I guess, it was the only one kind of musical number in the film. And we just basically tried to do it in one take. Our cameraman just devised some weird little kind of amateurish kind of steady cam thing that we strapped around his waist and killed his back, actually, after about three or four takes. The guy could hardly stand upright. But the idea was to do almost like a rock video, that this is the one moment in the film that's kind of like one of those great Massive Attack videos, or I think there's an Alanis Morissette video where she just kind of walks around New York and the camera tracks in front of her. And for me, there's always been something very nice about when I put on headphones and go for a walk. You know, that was the great beauty of the Walkman when it was first developed, was that you could just put on this Walkman, head into school, listening to you know, Earth, Wind and Fire, funky Earth, Wind and Fire song on the way into school when you were 13 years old, and you could kind of travel and go beyond yourself. Because music, for me, I was brought up on music on my knees in my dining room on this old, on my mother's old stereo, you know, through a mono speaker in front of you. It was always very location driven. You were sitting down at home having a cup of tea listening to this song, and that's for 10 years what music was like to me. And suddenly you were liberated. Now you could go and you could drive, or you, with a stereo in your car, or you could put your Walkman on and go for a cycle, or go for a run, or go for a walk. So I guess that was a nice way of having a scene that was slightly outside the naturalistic settings of all the other songs in the film.
And here's the crane shot.
Which we tried to do all in one take, and it was just impossible. The idea would be that you'd walk right from the shop all the way back, and then the cameraman would sit in this crane and go up into the sky, and it was just too much to do without a steady cam. We couldn't afford any of that stuff. But I like this kind of life goes on as usual.
Mara's working in a big posh house cleaning up. I was a little bit weird about the idea of him having a laptop, but John reckoned we'll just use an old one. So because the guy doesn't, in the film, without it ever really being mentioned, he doesn't have a mobile phone. It's kind of maybe, it's kind of almost shot in an older Dublin than the one we live in.
Hmm. The one you and I grew up in, Glen and I grew up in, which pre-mobile phones and SUVs and laptops and computers. So this character is a little bit, as you said before, drinks water from the tap. This is Marcella Plunkett, who's
John's ex.
Very funny.
No, joking.
Only she'll know what that means. But this is my footage of Marcella over the years that we came back. Actually, this is a reshoot. We hadn't got this scripted in the film, and we felt we needed to see, without having like a horrible flashback or something, we needed to see what a good relationship this guy had with his ex-girlfriend and how much of a draw she is and how he should kind of go back and get her. You know, that she's beautiful, that they had a laugh, and the idea of this scene is that he's watching these MPEGs that he took over the years of her, and you see how much potential their relationship had, and maybe that's worth going back for. So to me, this is kind of like, there's a whole new thing going on in this guy's head now. Maybe he could head off to London, and weirdly, through meeting this new woman, he's starting to reflect on this past
and
love.
It's going on in, I think, in the heads of the audience, because you get to see this girl, and I really like it for the reason that you're actually unsure whether you want him to go back to his girlfriend, who's really beautiful and who they've had a really nice relationship together, or to go for this person that he just met. I like the way that it's not, you know, it's not clear anymore from now on. Even though most of the times, that's not true. Actually, some people like the idea that he went back to his girlfriend, and some people wish that it had a different ending.
This is where she says, "Stop it, Johnny. If you could lip read," that's what she's saying.
So that's Johnny.
So the character's name is Johnny now, so me.
So me and Marcella spent a day together just filming extra stuff so that it would appear like it was our relationship, but actually all this stuff is John and Marcella's footage. Very private, I suppose.
Which makes it work. Because I think that she's very unself-conscious in it, like.
Yeah.
But it's amazing, you only need to show like two shots of you and her together, and you buy that the rest of it is you behind that camera.
Yeah. Look at that, this is interesting, the Holy Mary either side of me. This again was shot in someone's living room, and so whatever furniture or stuff they had, iconography, it was theirs.
I like that shot.
I never understand how you did this.
No?
No.
Oh, I'll show you. It's very simple. You just basically, when I turn around, I just stay still and I get her to leave the shot.
Too hard to describe.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Stick a whole masterclass in Charlie Chaplin filmmaking.
Yeah. Basically, she has a remote control for the camera in her hand. And when I do the one thing, she presses stop on the camera. Then she just gets up, walks out of the screen.
Oh, forget it. I don't.
I love the way he's persevering with this. Like, you will know. This is tough.
Yeah.
And it's Adrian Fraser. That's the Rendler Road. Back in old Dublin.
Old Dublin town. The tick blackety black.
So this is the scene that Glen was referring to earlier on, where a paparazzi guy has seen these two on the street and is clicking off at the very end of the scene.
I think we're paparazzi worthy, but
no, he's definitely taking a picture. He is, for some reason, on a long lens camera. Yeah.
It was really strange for me doing the scene because I was offering these flowers to people and everybody was just so narky.
Yeah.
Nobody, yeah. You know.
We don't like foreigners here in Dublin.
That girl was great, the girl in the background doing the poi.
Remember those women, the flower-selling women that got really...
They called Mar, what do they call her?
Bozzy.
We don't want any Bozzy selling, because these women, they're Dublin women who sell flowers and have been selling flowers there for 40, 50 years. And so the idea that you're walking up and down the street selling roses was really... This one of the women in the background there was really offensive to them, because they're the flower sellers, and they were calling you a Bozzy, as in, we don't want any Bosnians.
There's the cameraman right there.
It was very strange.
Where?
He was right behind us. This is Sun Studios. This would have been the studio where myself and John would have made our very first demo. And again, we went back to that just because it had resonance, I guess, with us.
Completely. We spent many a long evening till 2, 3, 4, 5 in the morning recording. And this is Niall, who I shared a flat with, who's an actor.
This scene is very unlike me, is that how you say it?
Yeah.
I'd never bargain like that with somebody. It's just not in me. My dad is very like that. I've seen him do it many times, but I just never have the balls to do that.
That's obviously where you got the muscle to do it then. She's always in the film. A few times she talks about how good the guy character is, and it was always really embarrassing.
But that's what I really like about the character. I love how supporting and encouraging she is.
Well, she's doing stuff that he'd never have the balls to do, I guess, in a way. He's kind of vacillating. She takes him shopping to Bogart's.
Remember this.
This is the first shot.
The very, very first scene. It was so nervous, the two of us.
I was feeling very sick there.
Day one of 17 days that it took us to shoot the film.
Okay, you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
This is a great shop. I actually do buy my clothes, or did buy lots of clothes here.
He was great.
That's one of Glenn's ad-libs there. This is Ratmines Road.
And the guy you're going to see now, the bank manager, his name is Sean Miller, and he's actually a brilliant songwriter, like a really talented songwriter. And in a way, this scene doesn't do him any justice as a songwriter, but doesn't great justice as a character, because he let himself come over as really...
Oh, God.
Kind of overly, not overly sincere, but just kind of, you know, very different to how he really is, because he's actually, he's a legend in Dublin.
But that's the great thing about people, aren't they? They're able to be self-deprecating. So he didn't give a shit, like...
No, he was totally fine with it.
And he wrote this song.
Can I show you something? I wanna be free.
Like, he wrote this song, but he wrote it obviously in an ironic sense.
Yeah.
For the character. He's one of the best songwriters in our country.
We had a whole scene here where he had the line "Spider's web" in this song, which Glen himself tried to improvise a line that rhymed with web.
That's Alistair who works in Whelan's.
That's Phil in it.
That's Phil.
Who's dead, sadly. But the statue of him is just off Grafton Street, which has just been put up recently. And people keep robbing the bass guitar, the Fender Precision. There's Conor McAllister, the hair makeup. Hair man, fully on camera. Alistair's great.
We only do Lizzie, is what he says, and you probably won't catch it, but... Here, is it Lizzie? Is it like Rocky Lizzie stuff?
So this is what you do when you're, if you know, if you needed to record a demo really quickly, go around his mates and pick up few musicians that he'd known in town. I like the idea of this scene.
No, it's not Lizzie, it's Rion songs.
We only did Lizzie.
We only did Lizzie. I love that.
That sort of stuff is just like a Rocky Lizzie stuff. No, it's not.
Yeah, singer songwriter stuff.
It's kind of singer songwriter, yeah. Kind of.
Is it any good?
It's
great.
Is it?
Again, she stands up for him.
I don't know much about them, but they seem like nice people.
Yeah, I just have to go on my mother first.
Cool. Let me
go.
That's him inviting her to a party, but again, it was the context is kind of just taken away. So you just get the feeling that they're about to go somewhere.
This is an enigmatic kind of weird shot, which is, we were going to cut out. And in the final cut of the film, a few people had said this is the one thing that we could drop from the film. And it's weird because it shouldn't work, but it kind of does, it doesn't tell you what he's thinking of really.
I was half asleep.
Or you were thinking of your bed.
So this is actually my flat in Dublin where we shot the party scene. And what we did was myself and Mar would throw parties for friends a lot. And this was just another one where we invited all of our friends. That's, you know, different people that we knew and felt close to. And that's David Cleary. He's the stills photographer on the film. And basically we set up the scene that he was the owner of the flat that we were going to. But so it was great. This is kind of on a personal level. This is really good because this is all friends.
So do you know what I've just realised? Al is there in that scene, dude. Alistair's just sitting in that scene.
But he could be a friend of the people that were going to hang out with.
But I've
never
actually seen that.
Yeah, I think that's interesting, actually.
David's girlfriend cooked the food. Usually we throw these parties normally, and I cook some Indian food, but that's actually Diane cooking. What was it, green curry?
Green curry. That's my mother now. And she's singing that.
When your liberty came, remember Mitchell far away, a convict bound in shame.
I thought that was nice to put her in the film. You know, she's a very strong character in your life.
At this heart of mine. And I love her so. I wouldn't trade her for gold. Walking on moonbeams, I was born with a silver spoon. And I'm gonna be, I'm gonna be free.
Like the way the female character is looking at the.
Well, what I like about it is that there's no big zoom into her or cut to her. Again, it's like the shot, the zoom, and you're kind of left to think. I don't know what she's thinking of.
Yeah.
I like that kind of cinema. Where you can kind of project your own stuff onto the actors.
That's your brother Richard behind Mara there.
For sunlight is light.
This is my first time I was ever sitting on a motorbike. It was so nice. So exciting.
I was going to go with the Vespa, and Glen very correctly, I think, said, what if it's an old Triumph or an old, you know, an old British, like a BSA or an old collector's bike?
But actually, because the father character owned the bike, I thought that an older sort of English bike would have been better. But
more,
actually,
much more appropriate, yeah.
Actually, then you recommend that we watch Leon Fon, the Dardenne brothers film, and that scene where he's rushing through the city with the child and the girl on the back of a moped was much more, was kind of so powerful that in a way it almost, maybe we could have gone for a moped. But then again, his dad wouldn't really own a moped.
No, this is perfect for his dad.
It was funny, I remember the day after we shot the scene, John came in with this newspaper that just came out, and somebody was talking about film cliches, and it was like, I hate, you know, when people go on motorbikes and into the nature and to countryside.
It was Peter Bradshaw in The Guardian, and he was saying if you wanted to show a good time, just put a couple on a motorbike, and it was so cliched, and we had just shot the scene the day before. I was like, oh, fuck. We wonder. I wonder what Peter Bradshaw will think of this film. Probably.
Does it surprise him?
Again, three or four lines of dialogue there cut out just straight into "you're married."
Yeah.
Question mark. So, I like that cut.
This was a great day.
2 years ago, when I find out I'm pregnant with you.
John was walking up the hill backwards with the camera, hard. And it was, he kept on tripping.
I have very good calf muscles, though.
It's over now.
But again, people, somebody was asking, what's the big deal that she's married if she has a kid? Why is that a revelation? I guess it's a revelation because she's so young.
But also, for me, it was, you know, when I came to Ireland, I've noticed that it's quite common for people to have kids but not be married, whereas in Czech Republic, it's not really common at all.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I can understand why people would be confused by that.
Mm.
This scene is incredible, yeah. That's view. So. Incredible. Up in there, it's Killiney Hill, right?
Mm. Yeah, Killiney Hill.
And isn't there a chair right beside us there where Jonathan Swift used to sit?
I don't know.
There is, right behind Mar there, actually.
There's such distance between me and him.
Which actually, I think I may have kissed a girl on that chair once.
Me too.
I'm fine on my own, you know? It's just, I don't want Ivana to grow up without a father.
This is the slightly corny bit, but... weirdly, I think we're.
What's the check for? They love
him. Mirasha?
Yeah.
But I think you're great in that way.
I was trying to figure out how to say it.
People always ask me, why am I saying
it? I know, but it's so obvious what you're saying. Like, I just thought it was a cute idea.
It's the
Neil Jordan's house.
People always. I'm sure that people know what I'm saying, but they need somebody to say, yes, that's right. Which I don't like, John.
That's true, I think. Yeah, exactly. Actually, they need to be told from the actor. Is that what you say?
Yeah.
But I think we should have done the thing where she says something really banal in Czech.
Yeah.
Nothing to do with them, but we didn't. This is the only fully improvised scene in the film, which was just like, you try and get the bike off him, and you say no, and it basically became one of the most charming scenes in the film, I think.
You know, I fell in love with this bike very deeply, and... It's kind of an anecdotal thing that I guess it can be in a commentary or not, is that Mar actually spent all the money she got from making the film on buying me the bike.
Which was she never ride?
I guess I just don't ride it because you need a special license for it, and it's so beautiful, and it was such a beautiful thing to do, to get it for me. But it's one of those things I'll have forever, and I'm very 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 proud of it.
Yeah, but it should be ridden.
You're right.
I'll see you tomorrow, yeah?
Okay, yes. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
I like the way they both say thank you there as well.
At the same time.
Well, it's just like thank you is such a strange thing to say after a day of hanging out with somebody. Thank you. But I thought it really summed up the two characters, weirdly. I like to watch people work. You know, I like to watch people compose songs or people paint paintings and... I think there's a fascinating side of life that rarely gets much time in film, in movies. Kind of the song is suddenly done, or the painting is suddenly painted, or the relationship is suddenly a relationship. I like the whole kind of coming together I like the idea of watching two people rather than, you know, finish a completed song, actually work a song out and work out the chorus and the verse. I think it's fascinating to watch people work. Again, here's something that could be so... naff, but weirdly
for me it was the commitments moment, the Jaffa cakes and tea.
Yeah, but it weirdly works, I think, just because Bill is such a good actor.
Kit set up, piano's waiting for you in the live room.
This guy's a great actor.
Tea and coffee in the kitchen as you came in, help yourselves, you'll need plenty. And
the sound engineer,
yeah,
around the corner if you want a snack. All right,
great.
Okay, Eamon, leave it to you.
Eamon was tough.
Yeah. Eamon's the only character in the film who has his own little mini arc.
Yeah, he definitely doesn't like these guys.
He's just bored, man. He's just so, you know, one of these guys that just got into sound engineering because it was a passion for about a week, and now it's just paying the rent. Couldn't give a fuck.
Yeah.
Well, partly it must be because he comes across so many bands that he's not into their music, and it must be, you know, if you have the choice to pick bands that you like and that you can get excited about, it must be much easier than to have to just take everything.
Absolutely. Mm. It must be an exhausting job working with music you don't like.
But this guy wears it on his, he doesn't hide it, like.
Doesn't even pretend. This was very enjoyable, actually, this whole scene. It was really, I really enjoyed it. Sort of setting up, you know, the classic, getting into the studio, getting the feel of the place.
Yeah, no, I can't do it, but I'm stuck here with the studio. And the idea here is that he's, I guess that he's just a jaded kind of sound engineer. That's Jeff Minogue, who's a great actor, who's been in a number of things I've done. He's kind of, he's got a great natural. He played a barman in a pub in a thing that we shot ages ago, and every time I walk into that pub, because it's a real location, I expect to see him, because he's so believable as the barman.
Whenever you're ready, yeah?
This is great.
I love that look she gives him. It's like she's waiting. How is he going to react?
Mm. We're ready for one.
Are you sure you're ready?
Okay, listen now for the click track, everybody. And away we go. This is track one, take one, yeah.
All right, here we go. This is it, yeah?
I always thought this was a bit much, the way he puts his feet up and opens the magazine. As in, he's poised for somebody who goes, hang on a second, these guys are really good. I guess this is kind of the equivalent of the toe-tapping producer. You know, a close-up of his toe tapping in the middle of the song. This is the equivalent.
Although I've definitely
been
in that situation where there's a guy sitting with a magazine. Really? While you're doing, of course, when you're doing your recording.
When there's nothing worth
tapping producer, hang on a second, these guys have got a number one hit.
I think he does it quite well. I mean,
it's just that he's a good actor. Exactly,
yeah, he turns around a little bit, but he doesn't kind of right. Does he praise us?
No, it's good direction again. This camera here, which I kind of like, because I really like this song. I thought this performance was amazing, the vocal performance here, and we just hung on this shot for so long. Great little smile from Eamon. Check out the end of this scene. This is so weird. It's just,
yeah, it is odd.
It's the one cut that doesn't really work in the film. The song ends, there's a beat of silence. Your man asks, did you write that? And Glen just goes, yeah. And it cuts, pretty much.
It's a really wacky scene.
And people don't get it. And I understand why they don't, but to me it was just, it just spoke volumes, weirdly, in a performance. It was just like, yeah. And again, now we're on a level playing field. Now there's respect, mutual respect between each other, and they can get on with it. But it's just a bit of dead air that doesn't work. I'd recut this end if I had a scissors.
If you ever want something and you call, then I'll come running.
You should have been in the band, John.
I was.
Okay. Wow. you write that?
Yeah.
Such a weirdo.
To me, it was just a great little moment of triumph for the lead character. It was right. Like, don't be writing me off before you've heard my songs
right.
And reading your magazines. But yeah, whatever.
I really enjoyed this part of the film because it kind of gives you it's kind of a montage of what's going on in the studio over this kind of wacky home recording.
Yeah. Every time I see a montage in a film, though, I can't help it. Ever since I've seen Team America,
montage.
Yeah, but you see, well, that scene was hilarious in Team America. I love montages because I love 40s films in which whenever you have to do any storytelling, you just cut to a montage.
I watched Rocky IV last night.
Great montages.
It was just all montage, yeah. The whole film.
Yeah, it's just one long training video, interspersed with the Rock. You gonna let him beat your Rock? Of course, Burgess Meredith, sadly, not with us anymore. Or is he? Does he just live forever, actually? I think he might be still alive, weirdly.
I think he is. I think I just saw him in a Wim Wenders movie.
On Grafton Street, I thought you were going to say.
No, he's in a Wim Wenders. The American Wim Wenders film.
He's brilliant.
Strange film. Yeah.
Yeah, this was a nice little moment of the shoot. Just kind of hanging out. It is what it is, really. A lot of this film is what
it's
it
actually,
is.
Yeah, this was just a camera in the room with us hanging out. On a break, more or less.
And again, this is the...
This is a kind of a weird one. There's no, is there no blonde priests or we we're all kind of supposed to be just, I guess we've been up and...
Spaced.
There's a couple of little tech bits, we can probably fix them, but, you know, it's 4 o'clock in the morning, so it's up to you guys. If you want to push through or...
This is the classic kind of 3 o'clock in the morning vibe, though, isn't it? Of just kind of,
yeah,
we could go home now and it would be a bit depressing, or we could just push through. And the fact that Eamon proffers that, I like as well, that he's on side this little unit now, he's part of the team. And it's also a lovely thing in life when somebody commits to your work and decides, I'm going to stay with this little outfit now and work with them. And here we cut across town from some studios. And now we're in Westland Row Studio, or you know, some other
studio.
That's
another studio with a piano in it. Yeah. We just needed a room for a piano. Another one of those weird ones was, why are they called matches? This is a great scene. I really always liked this scene. I think Mara's really great in this.
Thanks.
You are deadly.
Ideas. Go on, okay, I have one, but it's not finished, and I don't really.
Just play it.
Okay, but the lyrics are very rough.
Okay, be nice.
Okay.
There's a funny part in the beginning of the scene where the guy says something like, nice piano, and she says, what do you say? Like, yeah, it's a Baldwin. Mm-hmm. Well, it actually sounds like she's saying Alec Baldwin. Mm-hmm. Check it out next time you see it.
And you were worried about this shot, Glenn, when you saw the rough cut, because the way you look at her.
Yeah, because I was looking at her for the whole song.
Yeah. It's quite like, hello, I'm watching you.
No. You're ripping this film to pieces, mate.
All right, you've got to. We've seen it a million times now. Look at the way he's watching her. It's totally like a stalker. Oh, look.
Stop it, John. So I'm classically trained, a piano player. I started playing the piano when I was 6 or 7, because my mother, she always wanted to play piano, but her family, they were quite poor and they couldn't afford a piano. So then when she had a daughter, she really wanted me to play piano. So I did. I started taking classes every week, twice. And I never really enjoyed training, you know, like practicing hours and hours every day, pieces that I didn't like. And that kind of official part of it always bored me, you know. I wasn't a great, you know, I couldn't stay at the piano for hours and hours practicing. So then when I met Glen when I was 13, and I was kind of introduced to a whole different take on music, much more exciting take on music, which was, you know, very close to the idea of piano playing that I've always preferred. He would play me songs and ask me to join him on the piano, and I could make up my own parts, and that was really exciting. I could sit at the piano and have this total freedom. And then when I was invited on stage, it was a complete different kind of performance to what I was used to, you know, not playing these piano pieces, but playing something that, you know, I kind of wrote, accompanying somebody else, and that I really liked. And it was very exciting for me to be introduced to this whole different level of music.
Too under with me. Come on, we write loads of songs and live in a nice flat. You can bring Yvonne over. It'd be brilliant. Come on.
Yeah, we're going to London and no one will ever find us again.
No.
This is a nice moment because it's gonna... For me, what's nice about this is that she actually, when he jokingly says, come away to London, not jokingly, but semi kind of ironically says, do you want to come to London? And she says, yeah. And for a moment, they head off on this little journey. And she allows herself to imagine what it would be like, even in a fairy tale way, what it would be like to live with him in London, just disappear. And then she just brings him right down to earth with that last line. Would I bring my mother? And Glen, or the guy, is like, oh, yeah, it's not going to happen. Not in this life. And I like the fact that you can see everybody, each character there in that shot. It's a bit set up, but it doesn't appear to be. And this idea of the car test is based on myself and Glenn's experience of working with a record producer in London called Al Clay, who was a bit like that, very nice bloke. You'd work with him till about, you know, 5 o'clock in the morning. He'd say, come on, let's go and do the car test. And you'd take the, you know, you'd take the, because the discrepancy nowadays, car stereos are brilliant, but then, you know, there were little cassette players. And so you'd take the tape out because you'd been listening to it in big speakers all night and it sounded brilliant. And you'd take it out and you'd see what it would sound like to your average punter. And you'd remix then accordingly. You'd say, you know, the bass is too low,
right,
or the guitar isn't working there. And it was a really atmospheric thing to do at the end of a recording session, just to all bundle into a car and head off as the sun came up. And just before people hit the streets and went to their day jobs, you'd kind of have the city to yourself for a couple of hours.
And music always does tend to work better when you've got visuals. So, you know, you go out in the car and you put on the stereo and listen to the song you've been recording all night, looking at the city pass you by. And it would always definitely have a different atmosphere than looking at a mixing board. There's the pigeon towers in the background there now. This was a great morning. And this was basically us hanging out in the car on the way to the beach. And so John was just filming, but this is one part where we definitely fell out of character. And we're all just kind of hanging out. That's us playing Click's the Name of the Game. A game that was taught to us by Paddy Casey, which is a very interesting game.
And there's Timmy looking directly down the camera lens again, thank God.
As he does.
Look straight down the camera lens. Right, yeah. I'd also love to get the sound of this and figure out what's so funny that we were laughing about there.
Right.
And I love the way this ends, just on your man, Jeff. And again, I guess, I've read a few cynics or, critics of the film online saying, oh God, beach scene with people jumping around the beach. And I guess it is a cliche in one way, but to me it's kind of like, I have a frisbee in the back of my car. It's a great way to get an exercise, actually. Just put a frisbee in your car. See, look at
see how brutal I am. There's somebody who doesn't have a frisbee in the back of their car.
It's also a great opportunity, which I think you need for certain songs, to hear this song again in a film. So you're hooked now. For me, I always need to listen to a song a second time.
That was Mara telling me a joke, a very funny joke.
About a welder. Kind of master shot of everybody at the end with the sun bursting out. Great winter light in the month of January in Dublin. And the old Merc. I have a Merc in every film I've ever done. My dad buys old Mercs. You know, like 1, 2, 3 series. And this is the actual, our production offices for the film. This is Samson Films in Ring's End, aka Samson Studios, for this film. So we were literally just inside that blue door every morning, putting on makeup and getting ready to go out and shoot, and we just used that as the exterior of the...
The strange thing was the director put on makeup and the cameraman, but the cast didn't.
There's very little... This is a jump to 2 months later. We picked the scene up. As you can see, it's slightly sunnier and people aren't wearing coats anymore.
Gotta go this way.
So this was a bit of a rewrite. We had actually shot this scene, but when I watched the whole film, we decided to change a few lines.
It was very serious in the original take.
Yeah, that was it. He was more desperate. And there's a playful quality about this that we preferred.
What do you have to organise? What's that about?
And again, this is an example of putting cameras on long lenses. We had 3 cameras rolling on this scene. The one you've just seen, which was the wide shot, and these 2 angled shots, which are too tight, 2 shots, basically. And the actors are on radio mics, as you can hear, because it's very bad quality in the sound. This wasn't actually Robbie or normal sound man, but it was a different day. But this is a great way of just actors just without having big boom mics in their face and clapperboards and cameras right close to them. Look how natural they are together. It's just like they really are themselves.
No, it would.
They're free. They use their shoulders. You know, you use your shoulders. You move around more. You look up and down the street if the cameras aren't right. You can't actually, like, the way they're acting there, they couldn't even see the cameras were on that long a lens.
Back later.
This is the last time they see each other. She doesn't come.
Brilliant. You sure? Brilliant. Right then.
Cool.
Which is a weird way to say goodbye in a way, isn't it?
Yeah, that's it.
That's why I held on these shots for so long between them. Because that's it. She's not going to be coming to his house. And he kind of knows it, maybe. And he's back in the bedroom.
Waiting.
And basically, I just got Glen to check his watch in every one of these scenes. Checking my nail, check his watch here.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, it was bad direction. He's like, if you check your watch, we'll know you're waiting for her. Look, check your watch. Just have a quick look, go on.
I didn't even notice that before.
And just this great last shot, he just heads in and he goes, never see her again. And he knows what he's gonna do now.
Well, he's heading off to London in the morning, so that this is it.
This is my favourite scene in the film. I mean, in terms of just, it's just such good, he's so good in this scene. You both are really good in this scene, but it's, for me, it's in a way what the film was about for me, or one element of it was, leaving your parents at an early age and thinking of heading off somewhere. Because I was going to head off to London when I made this film, just before I made it. And one of the difficulties was, you know, if you don't leave your family and your friends when you're in your early 20s after college or whatever, it's harder each year. Your roots kind of get a little bit firmer, a little bit deeper. So I think that this character has a sincerely hard time parting with his father. And it's just so delicate and elegant the way this actor dealt with this dialogue and the way the character lets him go. There's no hard time whatsoever. Of course you gotta go. It's almost like he's been waiting for his son to cop on.
And I can totally feel the scene now that I've actually just moved to Ireland, and I was the same in my home. My parents were very happy for me to be, you know, getting this great opportunity to try living in a different country and experience something else.
And they could have easily, you know, gone on a guilt trip and made me feel really bad about leaving. But even though I know that was really hard for them, they were actually like, no, that's great, you know, fair play to you.
Interesting.
It's admirable about parents that, you know, they always think about you and what's best for you.
Well, this would be exactly my dad now. He wouldn't, you know, if you had to go and do work, you had to go and do work. He was of that. Because he left home himself when he was young.
Good.
Yeah. I recorded a few songs.
Oh, yeah? What are they like?
They're good. I'm happy with them.
Great. I've missed you.
Do you know what the scene really, why this belongs in this film?
Do you want me to meet you at the airport?
No. I'll come find you.
There's a great kind of relaxed expression about your face here, and then there's this kind of moment of doubt at the end of it. Is he doing the right thing? She says, hurry up, and he just looks a bit kind of, and then he smiles, and it's kind of like, and I love your man on the mobile phone in the background there as well. And if you listen really carefully, you can hear Marquette's voice in this scene. Oh no, it's in the next scene.
Was that on purpose, John?
Yeah.
Oh, was it?
We stole the scene where you were, when Glen is walking up Grafton Street kind of looking for her, you hear her actually say, flowers? And we stole it from earlier on and just slipped it in just as if it was kind of like a kind of a ghost-like.
Right.
You know, and it was kind of a thing like, did I hear that? Didn't I hear that? It was kind of to suggest that she'll never really be fully gone from his mind. He'll always think about her.
Ahoy.
Ahoy.
Is there something?
No.
Please.
This kid was great.
You know where she is, yeah?
She just cried during this whole scene. And we were devastated because we thought, oh my God, we'd be able to, the second we brought the Rushes home, it was like, she's brilliant. She does so much more than any fair, you know, poignant farewells or goodbyes. Just the idea of this little baby screaming as he's saying, I'm going. It's just great.
I'll write to her, yeah?
You write her a letter?
Here it comes.
You go?
Yeah.
Just makes the whole thing so tense and so kind of clipping on a plane when a baby is crying behind you, you know? Here's a little bit that you can hear at Markéta.
He looks around.
Yeah. So we just cheated that just before he looked around. We just slipped it in.
So I guess this is the scene where he goes in and remembers the first time they met and hung out, and then he buys her basically, well, obviously not that piano because that's a posh one, but buys her a piano.
Could I have a word with you about something back here?
Yeah, sure.
So then, this is where he buys her the piano, and I guess he buys the piano. I mean, there was a scene originally where he got some money off the bank manager. He got an extra €1,000 off the bank manager, which was rubbish. So now it's open to...
Well, it's kind of open between the father saying, I have a few bob saved up, and the bank manager, and it's not really clear where the money came from particularly. Which I like.
I like the idea of a woman, a musician, being in a town who's a pianist who can't afford to buy a piano. I think that really says something about Ireland at the moment.
The Aer Lingus self-check-in. Took me a while to get the hang of that. We did actually go to London this day because we had to shoot the last scene. So this is actually us heading off to London on the last day of shoot. So it was kind of a poignant day, actually. It was very kind of emotional. So it was me, John, and Tim, and Mar, actually. Mar came to London with us. And the irony is, in that very last scene, where the guy's walking down the, you know, and he's sitting on the tube or whatever, actually Mar's sitting right beside him, and John was thinking, wouldn't it be funny to just pan over, and there she actually went with him.
We didn't actually use that shot, so nobody's going to know what you're talking about.
Okay.
There.
Okay, I forgot.
But we had shot a shot of Glen on the tube.
So in the advert for the film, when she looks surprised there, so actually Mara's actually walking beside me there, which I think is kind of funny.
That is London. That's that thing that you walk past every time you go off to London, that annoying ad campaign for something or other. I'm glad I don't know what it means. I love this shot. The kids in the background down below. So yeah, this is life back to normal for her. He's gone out of her life. There's the husband, presumably with their kid. He's got a wedding ring. There's the Polish gentleman. And it's life is back to normal. And then this killer look to camera that Mara makes, which is kind of like, is it?
This is the moment of the film that I like most, is that Mara kind of just stops playing and looks into the lens, and the lens just pulls away. And for me, this just has the most poetry.
That glare of the sun is... This was a day that we had a crane shot and everything just came together. The sun, the music, the glare on the window, just everything was perfect.
And just as the bus leaves the screen, it's over. Written and directed by John Carney.
Me.
Well, that was it, everybody. That was our film.
Thanks for coming to our film.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Thanks for buying or renting this DVD.
Pants. Somebody in Dublin went around to all the posters and drew a perfect P in front of the once, which basically is Pants. And it was it was really, really well done. So fair play.
We'd love to know who that guy was. Big fan of the film. Good night.
Part that's